Okay, so this video is going to cover multiplying rational expressions. So the main thing that we need to keep in mind when it comes to rational expressions, multiplying rational expressions, is that the multiplication step is really just a combining step. And what I mean by that, so if I'm going to multiply this, now, before I even get into that, let's go back and review, well, how would we multiply fractions? And the reason why we want to review that is because rational expressions are really just fractions, right? So if I'm going to be multiplying rational expressions, it's just like multiplying fractions. And multiplying fractions is straight across. The numerator times the denominator, excuse me, the numerator times numerator, denominator times denominator. So I would say top times top, bottom times bottom. And we will go ahead and multiply this together. So just very quickly, maybe just let me throw in an example here that has numbers. Typically when we multiply fractions, we would do 1 times the 3, that would give us 3, over 2 times 4, which is 8. So kind of mirroring this, or very similar to this example that we have here, we would multiply numerator times numerator, so that's 2x squared times 12, over the 3 times x cubed. Now, we would want to leave our factors like this. And what I mean by that is we don't want to go ahead and do 2 times the 12 to get 24 and all that kind of stuff. And the reason why we would not do that is because what is our next step after multiplying a fraction? After we're done multiplying, or even after we're done dividing, adding or subtracting a fraction, our next step is, okay, well, let's simplify it. Well, when it comes to rational expressions, when we simplify our answer in the end, simplify in rational expressions means to factor. And factor is typically breaking things apart. So instead of multiplying these all together, we're going to keep them like this because we're going to end up wanting to break them apart anyways. So top times top, bottom times bottom, this is what that would look like. We're really just combining it all into one fraction together. So then, okay, so we've done the multiplying then. We're done multiplying. That's it. Now we need to simplify. But remember, when it comes to simplifying, we need to factor. So how could we factor this? So when it comes to factoring it, we need to take a look at our numerator and our denominator and see what we have so we know how we can break it apart. So the first thing that I see in our numerator is a 2x squared. Also remember, when it comes to factoring, we need to keep in mind, do we have one term or do we have two or more terms? If we just have one term, we're going to expand the factor. If we have two or more terms, then we need to use a factoring technique, which means do we have a greatest common factor? Is this difference of squares, reverse FOIL, or grouping? So taking a look at my numerator, that's actually all one term. We don't have any plus signs in that numerator. This is all one term. This is all being multiplied together. 2 times the x squared times the 12. So then we need to think about how can we expand this? How can we break it apart? Well, taking a look at the first thing in the numerator, we have a 2. 2 is a prime number, cannot be broken apart, so I'm just going to drop that down. The next thing we have is an x squared. An x squared is x times x. Then we have a 12. So 12 is a 3 times a 4. And then we can take that 4 and break it up to a 2 times a 2. So really, 12 is 3 times 2 times 2. In the denominator, we have a 3. 3 is a prime number, can't be broken up. X cubed, well, that means we have 3 of them. So now that we have everything in our numerator factored, everything in our denominator factored, now we can cancel common factors. So let's see. I have a 3 that can cancel with the 3. 2 of those X's will cancel. That's all that I see that we have in common. So now we just need to put back together everything. So in our numerator, I have a 2 times a 2 times a 2, which is 8. Over, I have an x left over in my denominator. So therefore, the solution to this here is 8 over x. Okay, so next example. So here, once again, we have multiplying rational expressions. So let's multiply. Top times top, bottom times bottom. So that would give me 3p minus 3 times 9p squared over p times 7p minus 7. Okay. All right, so that's top times top, bottom times bottom. That's our multiplying step, which is just a combining step. Now we need to simplify. So we need to think, how can we simplify our numerator, or how can we simplify our denominator, which means how can we factor this? So taking a look at the first thing that we have in our numerator, we have a 3p minus 3. So that's two terms, which means we need to think factoring technique, which starts with, do we have a greatest common factor? So I'm going to go ahead and pull down that 3p minus 3 so we can take a look at it. So first thing I noticed, well, hey, I have a 3 in common here, right? That's pretty obvious, hopefully, here. And I don't have a variable in each term, so it looks like 3 is the only thing that we do have in common. So I'm going to factor that out to the front and divide it out to see what we're going to be left with. 3 over 3 cancels, drop down that p, minus 3 over 3 is a 1. Okay, so that means 3p minus 3 factors to a 3 times a p minus 1. The next thing that I had there is a 9p squared. Well, 9p squared is one term, which means with this one we need to expand it out, which means 9 is a 3 times a 3, and p squared is p times p. And the denominator, we have a p, and that's to the first power, which means we just have one of them. And then we have that 7p minus 7, which I'm going to pull down here, because I do see that I have two terms, which means I'm going to have to use a factoring technique for this, which means I need to start by checking, do we have a greatest common factor? Which we do here, because I can see I do have the 7 in common. And that is what the greatest common factor is here, so I'm going to pull out the 7 and divide that out. Well, 7 over 7 cancels, leaving me with p. Drop down that minus sign, and 7 over 7 is 1. So I'm just going to fit that in over here to my denominator, so that's a 7, parentheses, p minus 1. Okay, so now that we're done factoring the numerator, we're done factoring the denominator, we can now cancel our common factor. So let's see what we have. We have a p minus 1 that cancels with the p minus 1. One of those p's will cancel out, and that looks like all we would have left over here. So let's see, in our numerator, we have a 3 times a 3 times a 3, which is 27. And then we have one of those p's left over. So I have a 27p left in the numerator. And the denominator, all I have is a 7 left over. So for this particular example, our answer is 27p over 7. Okay, so we need to start in our numerator with the first factor that we have there, the k squared plus 6k plus 8. And we need to factor that. So we need to think, how can we factor this? Well, we definitely have two or more terms, which means factoring technique, which means we also need to start with, do we have a greatest common factor? I don't see anything in common with our numbers there, and we do not have a variable in all three of our terms, which means we can go straight to using reverse FOIL here. So I'm just going to bring down this trinomial off to the side so I can work with it and factor it. So, drawing my parentheses, we first look at our first term, k squared, and think what times what will give us k squared, which is a k times a k. Then we look at our last term, which is the 8, and we think what times what is going to give us an 8? Well, a 1 times an 8, or a 2 times a 4 will give us that. And remember, we need the combination that's going to add to get our middle term, which is a 6 in this example. So that means we need the 2 and the 4. Also, we have it a little easy here with our signs. Notice that everything in our trinomial is positive, which means everything in our terms has to be positive. So I'm just going to take this k plus 2, and the k plus 4 and move it over so we can work on the next thing. So then the next thing we have in our numerator is another trinomial. We have k squared plus 14k plus 45. And same thing, we need to look and see, do we have a greatest common factor, which we don't here. Nothing in common with our numbers. We don't even have a number the first term. Technically it's a 1, but that doesn't count. We don't have a k in all three of our terms. And that means that we can go straight to drawing our parentheses. That means we look at our first term, which is a k squared, and the only way to get a k squared is a k times a k. Then we look at our last term, which is a 45, and we need to list all the possible factors of 45, which are 1 times 45 or 5 times 9. Those are the only options. Since we need the ones that add or subtract to get our middle term, which is a 14, we need the 5 and the 9. So I'm just going to plug those in here. Once again, we have it easy with our signs. Everything is positive in our trinomial, so everything is positive in our terms there, which means I'm just going to scooch this over. We have k plus 5 times the k plus 9. Moving down to our denominator, we have another trinomial. So here we have k squared plus 13k plus 36. So again, I'm going to draw my parentheses and go to factoring this. There is no greatest common factor here. It is a trinomial, so once again, we're going to use reverse FOIL. So I have k squared in front, which tells me k times k. Then we have that 36, which means we need to list all the factors of 36. 1 times 36, 2 times 18, 3 times 12, 4 times 9, and 6 times 6. We need the combination that'll add or subtract to get us a 13. So we need to look at all of these different combinations here and see which one will give us a 13, which is the 4 and the 9. So I'm going to plug that in there. And everything is positive in our factors. And I mean in our trinomial, so everything is positive in our factors. So I'm going to move this over. I have that k plus 4 times that k plus 9. And finally, we have our last trinomial to factor, this k squared plus 7k plus 10. Again, no greatest common factor. I'm going to draw parentheses and look at that first term, which tells me a k times a k. Looking at the last term that is a 10, the only factors of 10 are 1 times 10 and a 2 times a 5. And since that middle term is a 7, it needs to be the 2 and the 5. And everything is going to be positive in these factors because everything is positive in our trinomial. So I'm just going to plug this in over here. And now that we are finally done factoring, we can finally cancel our common terms. So let's see. K plus 2 cancels with K plus 2. K plus 4 cancels with K plus 4. K plus 9 cancels with K plus 9, and look at that, K plus 5 cancels with K plus 5. So this is the odd situation. This does not always happen. In this particular example, it did. Every single factor in the numerator canceled with the factors in the denominator. We have nothing left over, which means our answer is a 1. Remember, when everything in the numerator cancels, we have a 1 there. When everything in the denominator cancels, we have a 1. But 1 over 1 is just 1.